vast, mysterious universe, there spins a small planet, home to a human family that has come far in technological accomplishment, but has yet to coexist in peace and harmony. The struggle for equal human rights is ongoing. Food for Thought Productions is pleased to present a passionate fighter for human rights. Parvin Darabi is the sister of Dr. Homa Darabi, who set herself on fire in the public square and died to call attention to the plight of women in Iran. Ms. Darabi is the author of Rage Against the Veil, which details the deplorable conditions of women under Islamic rule. Here is Ms. Darabi speaking at the Center for Inquiry in Los Angeles.
And the situation with my sister that I have written the book Rage Against the Veil about her was that my sister finished medical school in Iran. Of course, this was during the Shah, during the time that we were a secular country. And then she came to America and she got three specialties, residency in pediatrics and psychiatry and child and adolescent psychiatry. But then in 1976, she said she really likes to go back to Iran because she felt that there are too many doctors in America, but Iranian people need doctors, especially since many of the children with some mental disorders at that time were just put into hospitals for people, you know, crazy people. They just put them in there. And my sister believed that a lot of these kids can be helped and they can be responsible adults and do something in the society. So she went back to Iran and she became professor at the University of Tehran and opened her own private practice and opened a hospital for the mentally disordered children and became very famous all over Iran. And then beside being a fantastic, great doctor, she was an outspoken feminist. And she spoke about the rights of women. And during the then revolution started, and like many other Iranians, she also felt that the revolution would bring democracy and freedom for all the people. So she was very much pro-revolution. And she wasn't pro-Khomeini, but she was pro-revolution. And Khomeini, of course, had told everyone that he would like to go to Iran and go to Qom, which is a center of the Shia Muslim religion, and practice his religion, and he was going to give the government to the people of Iran. So then when Khomeini came to the country, immediately he said that we want to have this Islamic Republic and that women should all go home because they should not be working outside the house. And that the only function for women was to bear children and raise them and take care of their husband. So they really didn't have any reason to be in the offices or in the government establishment. But then when they forced the women home, they found out that they cannot manage, because Iranian women were so involved in the day-to-day life of the government and the business establishment that men didn't know what to do. So they went back and they said, hey, we cannot do this. We have to bring these women back. And then Khomeini gave his order that, okay, women can come and do work, can work and be in the government established and business establishments, but they have to be covered. And that is how they brought this back, the hijab and the, you know, it's the mesh I have in here really is to support the Afghani women, because they even have it worse. At least the Iranian women, you know, they can show their eyes and the face, but the Afghani women, their face has to be covered behind a mesh of this nature, and they have to look through the mesh to see where they are going. And so then my sister started talking against this, and actually went and visited at that time Bani Sadr, that she complained to him about the hijab for the women, and this man turned around, at that time he was the president of the country, he turned around and said, you know what, women's hair gives a ray, that this ray excites men, and then men want to go and rape women, and we want to protect our women, so if we put the women at home and tell them to cover their heads, and then we won't have any problem. No woman is going to complain about rape, because it won't happen. And then my sister started speaking about this, and she went to a lot of places, and at one occasion when she spoke to a group of women and doctors, the minister or secretary of health was present, and my sister says, well, a woman without the cover or without the hijab cannot do anything. But with the hijab can do everything, even carrying weapon and bombs. And then the secretary of health didn't like this. So they came to her, and he told her boss or the head of the university to get rid of her. And they really couldn't do that, because my sister also was U.S. citizen, and this wouldn't have been so good to do such thing. So what they did is they came to her and they said that she had to cover herself and wear the strict rule of hijab. And that is really, you put a scarf that has a hole you put around your head and covers everything. Then you have this huge chador fabric that you put over it. And then you have to wear long, heavy stockings and a pair of black pants and black turtleneck shirt and everything. And just imagine, you know, in a heat of the summer, I mean, Tehran gets very close to 50 degrees. And for a woman to be covered with all this fabric is not a very comfortable situation to be in. And so my sister refused. And she said, no, I will never wear this chador. This is not a sign of dignity for women. This is a sign of slavery, and I will never accept slavery. And then she said, well, so they said, okay, then you're fired from your work. And they fired her. And she went to her own private practice, you know, and this is, of course, in more detail in the book. She went to her private practice, and they came and harassed her in her private practice as patient. And then one time the government even closed her private practice and put a note on the door that the doctor doesn't comply with the rule of hijab, so we close her business. And then they did it, so my sister then had to close the business too, because a lot of her patients started getting afraid that if they come to see the doctor, it might cause them problem. So then she closed the business, and for the first time in her life, she was forced to stay at home. And Homa had been such a great doctor. She had studied so many years, and one time I remember that we were driving together, and she had a small accident with the car because she was driving and somebody hit her. And Homa said, you know, it would be really terrible if I die now, because look at all the education, everything that I have learned that would go would be wasted, you know, because I'm not around to help all these patients I have. But then they did it to her, and she wasn't forced to go home. And then once we all know, I mean, we're all working women, or if we are not working outside, we are active women, we do things. What it would be if all of a sudden they force you to go in the house and do nothing, especially since my sister, her children, two daughters were grown women studying in United States, and she didn't know what to do with herself, so she started getting depressed. And then, of course, when I learned about it, I went back to Iran to try to bring my sister out. Then the husband would not allow it. He would not give the permission. And then, well, we did a lot. We went to the still US and Iran don't have a relation, but we went to the Swiss embassy asking if we could do anything because she was an American citizen, and it was that they really couldn't do anything, because if you become American citizen in the country of your birth, you're always the subject of that country, and America cannot do anything. They can do something for you any other place, but not in the country of your birth. And then we tried, but the government said she's his wife. She belongs to him, and he has the right. And if he doesn't want his wife to leave the country, she shouldn't leave the country. And then finally one day she got so frustrated with everything that she went and took, bought a can of gasoline and went in the northern Tehran in a square and poured it over herself and set herself on fire. And 10 hours later, she died. And I believe that if somebody would start making some records and getting names, birth dates and things, and would start counting the number of women in Muslim countries who have died due to executions, female genital mutilation, honor killings, bride burnings, in mental institution, lack of medical care, after flogging, and plain suicide, just plain suicide. Believe me, the number, the total would surpass all the victims of Holocaust, World War I, II, Civil War, Vietnam War, and Korean War all combined. The only thing is that these are women and nobody hears about them. In just 1 year in Iran, in one province, out of 3,000 suicides, 2,954 were women, because they just don't know what to do, and they rather to die than live under these barbaric and outdated conditions. And then, you know, the age of majority in Islam for a girl is 9 years of age, and for a boy, 15. And during the revolution, a lot of 9-10-year-old girls were executed by the government of Iran. And because Muslims believe that virgin girls go to heaven by default, and they didn't believe that these girls were worthy of heaven, they would send the soldiers, or you know, the pastoran, they call the Revolutionary Guard, to rape the girls before they execute them in the morning. And these were the things that really bothered my sister, and she felt so guilty because she thought that she also was pro-revolution. And I think I quit a little bit, and I would let my son, Raman Thompson, that he and I wrote the book, to read a few parts of the book.
So I thought I'd read a brief part of the book, and it won't take long, but it takes place after Homa had been fired from the University of Tehran, and it's a day that my mother actually took her for a walk in a park in Iran, and I'll just jump in the middle here. One day, this is from my mother's voice, one day I asked Homa to take a walk with me through the park Acai. We put on our Islamic robes and scarves, said goodbye to our mother, and we went walking. Park Acai is about 300 meters down a hill from our mother's front door. It's a lovely park with trees, flowers, and walkways built throughout. It also has a small zoo with animals and birds. The two of us walked to the center of the park and sat on one of the benches. As we watched people walk by, I asked Homa about her husband. Homa, why don't you ask your husband for his consent to come to America? She leaned back against the bench and looked straight out across the park. I don't know. I don't think it would help. She took a very long breath. I can't live in America. She raised her left hand and continued, this is my country. This is where I was born. You know, our father, his father, and even his father's father are all buried here. I guess I want to be here when I die as well. She looked around. Did you see the snow-covered peaks of the Alborz Mountains this morning? Things like that give me energy. I can't give them up. But Homa, why can't you live in America? I've been there for the past 28 years, and I've grown to love it. I miss it when I leave, even for a few days. You could be the same way. You can learn to love a second home if you try. It's different, she insisted. You left Iran before you had roots here. You were so young, you even learned their language so well that it's hard for you to speak your mother tongue anymore. She stopped for a while. I looked at her and started to notice my sister without the apathy that had been dominating her personality of late. She was almost arguing with me. You left to get as far from here as you could. It was always your dream. But my dream was to stay here and fight. I wanted to make this a better place for people. I wanted to bring democracy, equality, and happiness to the people of this nation. I can't leave now just because I failed. Why do you say that you failed? I failed in everything I've attempted. It started with my being fired from the university. From there, my life has gone nowhere because there is nowhere for it to go after my career. I failed with my marriage. I've been a poor mother and a useless one. What's left? But you're one of the finest doctors in this country. Even now, they have to admit that. You came from a poor family, and look at you now. What you've done is incredible. I chose the wrong specialty, she said. I wondered if she heard anything I was saying. I should have remained a pediatrician. These people don't understand what a psychiatrist is. They misuse my capabilities. I feel safe in these places. Do you remember what our father taught us about the four pillars of nationality? They were culture, language, race, and religion. I have all of them here in Iran. What do I have in America? I couldn't answer that question for her. Homa, you're being too idealistic. Look around. Look at the two of us, out in this warm weather, dressed like good Muslim women. Look what this country has done to you. They took away your highest passion. It's like one pillar of your nationality is wiping out the other three. This is not our culture. I can't understand why people would put up with these conditions. What else can they do, she said. Most people didn't foresee what we have in Iran today. They never thought it was that big of an issue to force women to wrap a loose scarf casually over their head. At the time, no one talked about flogging, beating, and stoning. The disciplinary measures came later. But Homa, I said, you have to be selfish once in a while. What about you? You deserve a better life. No, I've given my life up to chase a lie. I want you to come with me back to America. You can start again. I can't. She looked across the park. We sat alone for a while and watched the families pass by. It was a peaceful morning in the park. You could not hear the sounds of people rushing around the city in their cars. I saw our uncle coming towards us. Hussein, what are you doing here? Come sit with us, I said. I'm looking for Homa. He stood before us, but he wouldn't sit down. He was very nervous. What is the problem? Homa asked. They've arrested Azar, Mr. Homayun's youngest daughter, for violating the rules of hijab. She's going to be given 150 lashes unless Homa shows up in court to testify that the girl is insane. We have to help her. What did she do? I asked. Nothing. My uncle looked at me as if I'd asked a stupid question. Then I think he remembered that I lived in the United States. She's about 16, and she put on some makeup. She was picked up by the Revolutionary Guards. 150 lashes for wearing a little lipstick? That's unbelievable. He ignored my comment and kept his attention on my sister. Homa, you've got to help her. You know I don't like to do this, she said. It is better for her to take the punishment than to be marked as insane for the rest of her life. The scars will heal. Homa, please, these people are friends of mine, our uncle said. I don't think it's right, she responded. Her parents are desperate. They don't want the girl to be beaten. They think she won't be able to handle the pain. It could kill her. He was speaking frenetically. You have to come with me, Homa. Homa sat still for a while, and then she hung her head and gave in. Let's go, she said. They left. I walked back up the hill to our mother's house. I understood why Homa hated being who she was. As a pediatrician, they wouldn't call on her for those types of things. The young girl was in a mire, and Homa knew it. It's true, the beating may be too much for her, and she may lose her life because of it. But being labeled as insane has its own dire consequences. That girl would never be able to find a satisfying job or a husband for the rest of her life. She couldn't start a family, and she would be rejected by society. So after being fired from the university, and this is pretty much one of the what her life was reduced to, putting the children into a catch-22, where she could either come to a court and say the girl is not responsible for her actions because she's insane, and thereby destroy the girl's life because she would be marked as an insane person, or she could stand by and watch the young girl be beaten, flogged for a petty crime of wearing lipstick. So this was a very difficult dilemma for her to have to go through. So I'll give.
So, well, I can talk here till tomorrow morning about all these atrocities done to women in the name of God and religion. But if you have questions.
What are the beatings like?
Well, the beating is usually, you know, it's a club. It's very much like the, it's made from rubber. It's a rubber club like the police use sometimes. And they beat from, you know, it's kind of behind. And I have a picture that I didn't bring today, but we show it to a lot of people, is when they flog them with this rubber, and sometime maybe some metal in it or things, and the women get black and blue all the way, and sometime for a few years, they cannot lay on their back, they cannot sit, and it is a disgusting thing to look at how they beat these women. They did another thing in Iran. You know, when they arrested younger girls, young women, and they would give them, before they flogged them, they would give them a cotton ball immersed in little pieces of glass. And they would ask them to clean the makeup. And as the girls cleaned the makeup they forced them to do, the glass would cut through their face. And then the guards would say, good, now you remember to never wear makeup again. You see, the whole Islamic idea that men and women, they always talk about men and women as cotton and fire. So, you know, if you put the cotton and fire together, then they catch fire. You know, it's just that I always say, well, if that is the case, then we in America and Western world, we must have fires reaching the sky because we have this cotton and fire always next to each other. And that is, they just want to teach girls that they should not be pretty.
You've written a book critical of this religious regime, like Salman Rushdie. Aren't you afraid of a fatwa, a death warrant?
Well, you know, first of all, Khomeini is dead, and he was the one who issued the fatwa. And I don't think the Iranian government wants to do that again, because so far they really are hurting and having a big problem over this issue of Salman Rushdie. And of course, it is quite dangerous for me to go to Iran. And a lot of times here, I get calls from people that, you know, they are against the things I say, or they threaten me. But I don't think that there would ever be, I mean, this is my thinking, of course, never say for sure, but I don't think they would issue a fatwa against me.
How do the men in Iran feel about these horrible practices against women? Are they doing anything to change conditions?
There are a lot of men that are unhappy with the situation, but unfortunately there aren't that many of them, because a lot, in a way, we believe, a lot of us believe, that the revolution came because men were losing all these powers. When in 1963, Shah gave women the right to vote, and then passed the Family Protection Act. With the Family Protection Act, it was that men could not marry have more than one wife at a time, and that women could go ask for divorce, and women could get custody of their children. All the laws regarding women was changed, and this brought quite an unhappiness between the men, especially the bazaaris, the merchants, you know, because they kind of liked it, you know, that they go home and they have all these women running around and do things for them. And of course, a lot of times the women competed with each other because they wanted to be the most favorite wife. And if they did, they could get a nicer, you know, a nice clothes, a little bit more money or something like that, because these women could not work or do anything. And a lot of us are under this belief that that is how then they gave rise to Khomeini.
We hope you have found this program intellectually stimulating, and that you will continue to investigate the ideas raised here. To connect with other like-minded individuals, please contact any of the dozens of free thought organizations, such as the American Humanist Association, American Atheists, the Center for Inquiry, and Atheists United. You may also email the producer directly via leebaker27@gmail.com. This program has been distributed through the courtesy of Atheists United.